this is Steve Segura with ECTV. Today we had a press conference with Attorney General Greg Zoeller and Mayor Anthony Copeland. The announcement was that the City of East Chicago received over $333,666 from the state. This includes $145,416 collected from Pastrick by the bankruptcy trustee, as well as $186,250 in settlements paid to the state by Pastrick's other co-defendants in the RICO case. This concludes the state's direct participation in this part of the case, and the judgment remains in effect.
Let me start off by just welcoming everyone here today. Press conference that we will be holding with the Attorney General Greg Zoeller and members of his staff. Also, we have with us a former Attorney General Steve Carter, and also to my left we have the current Council President Mr. Lenny Franciski, and I, being Mayor Anthony Copeland. We're coming here today to bring closure to a case that seems to have perpetuated itself for a long period of time. And from the hard work of the Attorney General's office, we can finally say this day has arrived. I'm gonna turn this over to Mr. Zoeller, and we'll go from there, and then I can come back and give a brief statement, an overview on how I feel.
Well, thank you, Mayor, and I think, you know, we do look back over the last 10 years, so we now conclude the activity of the Office of the Attorney General, at least in terms of what we started, which started out as a State Board of Accounts audit. So over those last 10 years, the Office of the Attorney General, again, started with my predecessor, Steve Carter, and continued in my administration, but it's really the Office of the Attorney General. It's not just the office holders that showed both the persistence and I think the patience to do something which government often doesn't do, which is follow through on what's a difficult and let's say a long-lasting case. So, but the 10 years are now behind us, and I think today really marks this milestone in restoring the public trust of the people of East Chicago. I think I would start off by saluting Mayor Copeland and his administration, the members of the Common Council, who've shown a willingness to address the problems of the past, but also focus on the future and a ethical administration, city government that really hopes to earn and restore the trust of the people of East Chicago. So today, it's not so much looking back over the history, which has created a legacy of distrust to the public, but looking forward to a future of regaining and restoring the public's trust in their government. I mentioned to the mayor earlier that all government constantly seeks to maintain the respect and the trust of the people that elect us and that we govern, but it's really an effort that should continue every day, whether it's state government, federal government, local government. But it's the obligation of all elected officials and people who serve in government to strive to earn and maintain the trust of the public. So today really marks that new milestone for the City of East Chicago, the opportunities and a new optimism that people can look forward to a city government that restores and earns their trust, but also is one that delivers the benefits that government has to offer. So it's really a great day to celebrate this new chapter in East Chicago's history, again recognizing where we've come from, but also looking forward to the future in a way that should have the optimism of the people of East Chicago. It's a happier day than many of the days I've been up to East Chicago. I've attended a number of meetings before the Common Council. We've had interesting conversations between the leadership here over the last decade. But I do look forward to a continued relationship in supporting the efforts that have been begun by Mayor Copeland and the Common Council to earn and restore the public's trust. So that's it's a great day.
And with that said, last night and on into the wee hours of the morning, I was trying to think of something that would, just a few lines that would capture the spirit of this moment. And I came across a quote by George Santa Anna. And he said, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. And so I asked myself, what have we done to not repeat it? And let me just share with you some of the things that we've done for increasing accountability in the city of East Chicago. When it comes to ethics, we instituted ethics training for all administrators and employees. We've joined the Shared Ethics Committee. More stringent bidding requirements. Departments must always seek three bids. The city has increased its review of all budget and budgetary processes across all city agencies. We've standardized accounting procedures across all departments, including redevelopment. The city council now has a financial advisor to advise them in financial matters. All contracts have been revised to increase accountability and require timely billing. More stringent city nepotism ordinances have been put in place. We've went beyond what the state law required us to comply with the nepotism law. We increased transparency by televising public meetings. We put the public meetings on the city website. And public information requests are honored in a timely fashion. And the city council now has a committee process that is truly transparent, and they meet frequently, more than they have in the history of the council. So these are just a few things that we have done that we feel that is necessary to regain, like the Attorney General said, the trust of the public. And the first way that is done is bringing things out of the dark into the light, and we have truly given them that opportunity to come through a public meeting process.
Well, I'll add that not only do we celebrate kind of a new chapter, but in the spirit of the work that our office has done to try to help you with today, we also bring the funds from the RICO case and the bankruptcy, and so I think there was over $330,000 that are restored to the rightful owners here in City of East Chicago. So it's not everything that we might have wanted, but it's what the bankruptcy court would allow. Mm-hmm. And we hope that that's at least a sign that it's more than just a verbal pat on the back and support, but also the hard work of a lot of lawyers to pursue and at least show some justice out of, let's say, the past 10-year history.
Well, I can say, again, during the night until the wee hours of the morning, I was contemplating how do you get the greater good with that amount of money. And I said, where can we put these monies where the public would have the greater or the greatest access to that? And the City of East Chicago is committed to put this money into an effort where we truly need it, and that's in our parks. The public goes to the parks regularly. You can see on any given summer day, our parks are full. We were in dire need of new park equipment. and new amenities in the park, and every one of these dollars we will assign to that task where the greater good could be shared. So that's the commitment that we see we're doing with those dollars.
Well, I'm going to bring the Zoeller family up one time to join you at one at the park.
Okay.
How's that for a...
And we have with us Mr. Carter, former Attorney General. I'm quite sure did this start on your watch?
It did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Would you like to have a flashback?
The solution started then.
Okay.
The problem started long before that.
Well, are you getting a flashback moment at this time that you would like to say a few words?
Well, I do sense a new atmosphere here. There's some fresh air. The door's open, and the people are working together here, looking toward a future of honest government in this part of the state. And it hasn't always been that way. 10 years ago, the city was experiencing electoral questions. That was documented that those were serious questions, problems with financial management of resources, mayor not trying to work with others within city government or those within state government who were concerned about these problems. You didn't have that kind of cooperation. So today it's nice to see the executive branch and the legislative branch working together, looking forward to a better future for this city. It's also good to see the executive working with at the local level, working with the executive at the state level, not trying to avoid transparency. And it's clear that you've identified some steps or moving forward, and I'm sure everybody in this part of the state is very hopeful. The proof will be in the pudding. You know, we'll have to come back in a few years and see how things went, but I think everybody's optimistic. And it is different. When we started on this path 10 years ago, we didn't know where it would lead. But it has led to some changes that I think we all feel very hopeful about.
You know, I can add that during the inaugural, the President Attorney General came up to see the inaugural here in the city of East Chicago and the city of Gary. And I can remember then advice that he had given me. And he said, if you want to restore accountability, the first step that he felt in that process that the city of East Chicago should step up and do what maybe some of the other major cities in this area, we should lead by example and join the Shared Ethics Committee. And shortly after that, I took that advice and we haven't looked back. And I was sharing with him just some of the low-hanging fruit that has come from that. Just the re-education of the workforce itself, some of just little common practices that the workforce did and they took it for granted, they now see is wrong. But it had been done for so long that the wrong has been accepted as being right. But now the same employees are now going through an educational process that is enlightening them that even the little bitty things add up and they are not acceptable practices. So we've already reaped benefits from your advice that you've given me when I first stood there with my hand in the air pledging that before God that I will adhere to the laws of the state of Indiana.
Well, I too remember your inauguration, and I hope it didn't put a cloud over the day, but I explained that the authority of the Office of the Attorney General doesn't allow me to trust anyone.
Yeah, he told me that.
That's not in the statutory authority. But I think personally, I can say over your term here, I think at least personally, I can say that you've done a lot to, and I hope it reflects the fact that the people of East Chicago have more trust. So you've earned trust in others, even though I'll have to say that it's not my job to trust anybody. That's...
And it was advice well taken.
Okay. Well, I think the fact that I don't know, 10 years ago that we were asked to come into the mayor's office when we started this. So it's nice to be inside talking about this rather than at the courthouse. So.
Yes.
We got time for some questions.
Obviously, you know, any money returned is a good thing, but at the same time, relatively speaking, compared to the total amount that was taken from the city, it's small in comparison. I'm assuming, I mean, are there going to be any more attempts to get the rest of the money back, or even just some more, or is this basically it then?
The judgment is still maintained, so, you know, it's a $108 million judgment, and it's on each of the defendants. So in some respects, somebody hits the lottery or something,
okay,
or, you know, we can certainly continue. But when you go through the bankruptcy process, the trustee, they did decide that damages from a RICO, which again, it's the first time in U.S. history that a municipal corporation was adjudicated as the corrupt organization in the RICO. And it also serves as the first instance where the damages in RICO were challenged as whether they were to be dischargeable in a federal bankruptcy court. So we now have a new order that shows that it's non-dischargeable. So there's been a lot of law made, at least cases that stand in a precedent that, but I think that bankruptcy does say that you can only get what you can get, and the $331,000 plus was what we could get. So,
what was your reaction when the bankruptcy ruled that this cannot be dismissed?
Well, I thought just as a lawyer that, you know, fraud is non-dischargeable. So I thought RICO really sounded in fraud. So we were anxious to make that clear. But again, there had never been a RICO judgment that went through a bankruptcy. So it was not that I was surprised at it, but that it had just, it's the case of first impression. So again, there's a lot of legal history that's been made here as well. I don't know that I'd want to do it again, but I'm glad that we've concluded it. And again, it's you look forward and not always back.
What did the investigation, prosecution, all of that cost?
Well, we could probably get you some, you know, specifics, because the way this worked from, you know, the 10-year process, we used some of the funds that were collected early in the RICO case against other defendants. We used those funds to hire some of the outside legal work that was required. We hired a bankruptcy law firm. We hired a forensic accountant. So there was an awful lot of expenses, but it was all that's why the funds from the case itself were used to pay for those things. So I do think it was well spent, but we could get you more on that if you wanted to see the costs of it.
There was a conscious decision by the Attorney General's office to devote resources to trying to fix some of the problems in East Chicago. That was clear. It's not to say it's without a cost, but remember, citizens and businesses of East Chicago pay taxes to state government. So this was a decision of state government to expend some resources to try to fix some things in East Chicago. So it's a conscious decision. And I would flip the question around too and say, what was the cost for decades of corruption?
That would be the next question.
It wasn't taken seriously by officials that were in a position to do that.
Mr. Carter, you know, the case there, you know, when you were Attorney General, it's now 9 years later. It's been a while. How does it feel to finally see this case that you started finally, you know, for the most part, resolved?
Well, As Attorney General Zoeller said, one, I'm impressed with the people that devoted their time and energy to this over many years. Many obstacles were put up from trying to prevent there being a new election to trying to prevent there being accountability for the city funds, put up with many objections through the years, so the persistence is impressive to me. I want to compliment Greg Zoeller too. Sometimes when you take office, you inherit situations that aren't a lot of fun to pursue and are difficult, but he was able to continue to work through a difficult case here, bringing it to fruition with many good results. I think it sends a strong message to the citizens of East Chicago that the corruption that was observed was not going to be overlooked. Something would be done about it. There were complaints from many elections in prior years, and many felt those things were swept under the rug. The Attorney General's office decided not to let that happen in 2004. That attitude continued when Greg became Attorney General, and I think citizens of East Chicago probably appreciate that. It also is helpful to the citizens of Lake County to see that state officials will take these problems seriously and try to do something about it to enhance the image of the entire county when elected officials and others go downstate and seek involvement from the rest of Indiana.
Got time for one more question.
Speaking of involvement, are there any plans to continue oversight on behalf of the Attorney General's office?
Well, yes. No, we have an office over in Hobart, so I mean we've doubled the strength of our, let's say, our legal footprint up here. But you know, of all the years that I've been coming up to the region, starting when I worked for Senator Quayle and when I worked for Attorney General Carter and now on my own, you know, I often hear people complain that people in Indianapolis don't pay enough attention to Lake County. Well, I'm from New Albany, so at the farthest end of the state, and the people down there have the same complaint that they don't get enough attention from the Capitol. Steve Carter is a native of Lake County, but I can say from, you know, the Office of the Attorney General over the last, now, the two administrations, there has been a dedication of resources to focus on some of the issues in Lake County and the region, and there will continue to be so long as I'm Attorney General. So we'll still hear the complaints that there's not enough attention paid, but it won't be complaints of the Office of the Attorney General. Quit while we're ahead.
All right.